pleasure to be here. And yeah, I will introduce some technique to plot data and essentially ask you, do you want to be famous? Do you want to be like a rock star and touch audience that go beyond the university? And probably the answer is yes, so it's a rhetorical question. And after looking some advanced way to interact with information today. So I come from New York, so essentially I am working in this place, and cognitive visualization lab is my lab, and leading this unit. And the idea is that maybe we can use a study about human perception to increase a way to evaluate a visualization, increase the quality of visualization. So when I started 2 years ago, I was so excited about that, and I started to say, well, we have to go deep. We have to understand what way human brain work. So I started to collaborate with a different professor in Harvard and MIT, and we was following this experiment to put people inside to this MRI brain scanner, and try to understand what happened when you're looking picture like that. And I was surprised that this type of experiment, because of course I don't come from the field of neurosciences, and so different people was inside to this MRI scanner, and we tried to understand, my idea was to, okay, let's try to build a visualization that these scientists to understand the data that come from this tool, but the more I want to use this experience to really have a big overview about the way that our brain works, especially the connection between our visual perception and brain activity. So we build this tool where essentially we translate this information in a network, so you will see essentially, where is the place there is they receive more oxygen from the blood that is activated when you see some picture. And of course, after many experiments, scientists have a model, and essentially they can say, well, when a person look at face, probably this area of the brain will be activated. And so we can create this link of prediction in function to the model. Of course, every single brain is different, so in reality, yeah, kind of we can see similar network, but not so similar. So in this case, you can see a picture from the top of the brain. Of course, it's not so really useful for you because you don't really know the structure of the brain. Maybe some of you, yes. So, but maybe you are very familiar with the network. So essentially, you can easily transfer this map of brain activity in a network visualization. So this is a tool that, of course, one is important point I want to share with you is build visualization is great, but they have to be able to be shared with everybody. So you have to build visualization that are online, on the web, and easy to open everywhere, from laptop, from the iPad. So, and this type of technique, of course, is time consuming, and probably some of you know how much is hard to build with technology like WebGL, this type of tool. But you know, many people can log in and play. In this case, you can touch the node, identify where is the location in the brain of this area that is activated during this experiment, and understand what the correlation of other brain area. So after that, I was so I start to be very excited to talk about cognitive visualization. I was thinking was a strong connection between idea to understand the brain. And after this experiment, I was thinking, well, maybe I have to change the name of my lab, but it was too late, because we're not ready yet to really understand what's happening in our brain, where we are looking picture. And okay, is it nice to know that some part of the brain activate when we are looking some picture? Now experiments are more complex. They are not just 4 picture, but much more, 26 picture in one of the last experiment in MIT. But you know, if you have this type of question, who care about what type of area of brain is activated, you want to know much more. And you want to know why your visualization work for some audience or not. So, and the problem is very complex. And so we have to use other techniques. So we have to feel a little bit like an artist. This is the big things that I want to share with you. Essentially, DataViz is like a between science and art, because we still don't know very well what really activates our excitement when we're looking visualization. But we need to make a choice when we have to plot our data. So essentially, at the moment, the field is very divided between these two extremes. Think about visualization like a way to create a excitement about the data set. In this case, is a cost of diamond over the time. So on the left, you can see if the cost is very high, maybe if you propose to start to, no, for a date to a girl, you'll be more successful, the diamond is very expensive. So this idea from this designer to, no, to plot this curve on top to the leg of a woman. Sorry, maybe it's not so polite. In America, in USA, nobody liked this slide. I think in Europe, we're a little bit more. Well, and the right, there is another methodology. Well, you have to be super clean. Frequently, when you open a report, a scientific report, when you're looking at a paper, you have the second approach, super clean. Essentially, you optimize the quantity of information for every single pixel on the screen. So I want to propose you a new type of job. Well, I have a job, so I don't need that you hire me, but I want to open this perspective. Think about that, is it possible to be like the Spielberg of DataViz? No. Okay, I consider myself, no, there are so many people that work in this field, so I don't just talk about myself. So if you look in this perspective, that when you have the data, you can transform this data in an amazing movie, something that people want to see, want to follow, want to discover new information. So you can have this new paradigm where you have the data that you use, structured and unstructured data to make your experiment. Many of you are in this scientist area, so you use this data to have new idea and to discover in what way our complex world work. And after you make a paper, a publication, but I want to say that publication is no more enough if you really want to change the world, and you know that very well. So you want to do something more. And some of you are using good visualization to explain the result of this research. But you know, every single data visualization is like an actor in a movie. So you have the script, is your paper, and after you have to choose, in my work of director of data, data director, I have to select the right actor to play in this story. And after play, different movie, if you want, is like user experience area. And so I use different user to understand what works well, what doesn't work too well. And after I release the movie, as a movie, of course, is not just a video, it's an interactive tool. So yesterday, sorry, it was not really time to plot some of, to put in my presentation some of the great visualization that I saw today, but we saw some of the examples of a way to use visualization. So probably you remember from this video that there is this increasing of CO2 emission. And you know, you're a scientist, you know very well, you need a video, but many people need this video. And after, there are some examples I think are really great. And Professor Pietro Nero is here, so hi. And I think it's really great, this visualization, because the metaphor is perfect. So there is a storm in economic market. How many times economists talk in this way, with this metaphor? So you have this sense of wind of the way the economy goes. So this is when you will see this flower, it's because I want to really share with you something important. I want to say that, we can able to control in the way media work. Media are looking for great story. Story great is simple to understand, but great story. So scientists are the main actor in producing amazing story. But the problem, many people in the media cannot really understand and follow you. And sometimes they create like a little area field in a journal, in a television, where they dedicate, you know, some space in the science communication. But everybody knows this is boring, everybody knows this is complex, everybody change the channel or go to the next page to follow sport, things like that. But sometimes it's possible to do something great. Like in my experience, this is just something that happened the last month. You can see, my work is in this book that is released every year in USA, The Best American Infographics. So I'm here again, and again is Nature Physics. Frequently, I help my friend. I live in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Help my friend to have a great cover that people can remember. And have a great cover is not just have something beautiful. It has like a meme that you put in the that you share with people to remember the content of your publication. So it's very, very important. And sometimes some video they produce become so popular, there was this very rarely case, both Nature and scientists decide to publish on the home page this work that now we'll see. And after, of course, just a few weeks ago, I was in Riga to opening this DataDrift exposition. It's a museum of Kim, a contemporary art museum, where they expose some of my work. So let's see together very briefly what's mean creative storytelling with the data.
The great Renaissance artist Leonardo da Vinci was born near Florence. Known throughout Europe, he was employed by the King of France late in his life. He died in Amboise in the Loire. Da Vinci is one of over 100,000 notable people whose birthplaces and deathbeds have been mapped in this animation. It's the work of a team led by Maximilian Schich, based at the University of Texas. The team wanted to chart hundreds of years of culture. Births are blue, deaths are red. Let's start in the Far East. This is 17th century Japan, just opening up to the West. Many of these names are Christian missionaries to the country, some persecuted here for their faith. In 19th century Australia, migration from Europe increases the traffic. If you watch this full screen, you might make out some names, among them the infamous bushranger Ned Kelly, born in the 1850s. His father was Irish, transported to Australia for stealing pigs. Back in time now to the Roman Empire. There goes Galen.
So, of course, I don't want to use all my time to look at a video that you can find online, but just to introduce you for people that maybe don't have time or will not remember to go to watch this video. So, more than 1 million people in just a few months, and it's growing. So you can have a very huge audience. And now this video is one of the most successful data visualization in a nature channel. And it's not just a video, it's an interactive tool. So you can play, listen to the voice in function to the story that you want to follow, like before to come here I was playing with a tool online and touch. Oh, the resolution is not so great, but is your city here. We are here in Vienna, and you can see many people decide to die in Vienna, not because well, you have to behave. Interpretation of what this mean, decide to, if you are a famous artist, probably in the history, artists was people able to travel because they was able to sell this paint and produce this paint everywhere they were. And so the idea is that decide to die in a city was like a decision frequently. Now, go where there are rich people able to support you, mecenate people. So Vienna probably is one of the examples of the city where the quality of life was for many centuries so high that pushed so many cultural people from theater, from school painter, many type of people that really changed our culture over the time to come here. And you can use this type of information in a field of data journalism. So just to clarify, this is not my work. All the other work that you will see, except this, the next one, is not mine. But I think I decided to show you something that comes from other people too, just to tell you that there are some successful work in data journalism. I'm not from the field of data journalism. I'm like I work just with scientists. Journalists have power of team of 20 people to build this interactive tool. In this case, to monitoring the number of immigrants. They are moving now to Germany and Austria. So you can see all these people moving to you. And I understand you can click different areas to understand many people are coming from different location around Europe. Or another very famous data journalist interactive tool where you can see there are just these 8 keywords, and you can touch one of these keywords and see what's going on around the world, how many people are using Google to explore this type of topics, and in what way they want to explore the topics, with what question. Very interesting, like kind of poetic, can be more interactive, but you know, in the data journalist field, usually you try to do very fast and release something appealing but fast. In 2008, when I started my experience in the US working with in MIT, I was very lucky to enter in this laboratory, Sensible City Lab, and my collaboration started with at the end of the project, New York Exchange. But I frequently use this word to tell you that. To tell my audience that data is visualization is not just something that is useful for you, but is useful for people to understand what's going on. So this was exposed in a MoMA for many months, and And essentially, the idea is to create a perception of what is the sense of using your mobile phone today. So this is a video that presents in what way, in many ways, New York is connected with all the rest of the planet. So, and every single link is a communication by IP, so using internet or using phone call, making phone call. And you can see how much New York is connected over the time with different areas of the, around the world. So, and now I think very quickly, 1 minute of this video, they maybe can. Well, can help you to understand in what way share a paper directly with the audience and simplify the content of the paper, create a story that's more easy to understand. And there's some consequence of that, of course. Like BBC used this video to communicate to people in England, well, you know, maybe we can divide England now, because we have scientific proof that we are not the same with the north part of England. So essentially, different parties start to contact our lab to say, can we use this tool to demonstrate that North Italy don't have any connection with South Italy? Well, and in Belgium was the same question. So become popular, of course, for a few weeks, few months, can have some big consequence. But in general, it's very useful. And in this case, a video that I make for the BBC help you to understand what's going on with the concept of a smart city. So essentially, I plot in this video all the type of data that come from city of Dublin. So in this case, a bike available, or parking available, and over the time. So you have this 3D dimension where you can see an overview of what's going on in Dublin, and after a 2D layer where you can see more analytically, and you can put different analytical tool on top, analyze this information. You can touch the information from the 3D layer and grab in the 2D layer to analyze that. Of course, I don't put in evidence all the interactive tool component of this interface. So, by essentially, we absorb information from Twitter and for all the sensors around the city. So, you can have this chaotic but very poetic, I think, overview of what's going on in your city. You understand that there is not just a physical layer, but digital layer that is going on. You can filter this data and touch just what you are looking for, and looking like the movement of bus transportation, understand what are the area where there are some problem of in the, like when you are red color, the medium velocity of the bus is a little bit low. When you have the green area, you have a very good performance of the street. Essentially, the idea is, again, try to understand when is a case, when is important, really use our brain capability to look in the information and to transform this information in a great story. Of course, there are so many things to consider, but I think we can really, in the case of bus transportation in Dublin, understand that we share thousands of data in very few seconds, and people can get it immediately, understand what is wrong in what area. So I want to give you this appeal, this suggestion. When you build an interactive tool, try to create this sense of, if you want, gamification of the experience. Push people, image that you can build something that will not just be in your website, but in an important museum like a MoMA. And try to create this tool that can engage people to play with data constantly. I think you can see, wow, it's so complicated to do all this stuff. Maybe it's too much resource, money to really build all these type of technology. But I want to give you a bad news. In reality, this is really something that was good 5 years ago. Now we move beyond that. And now we're using a different way to interact with data. So you didn't really touch the data. You really touch the model that tried to understand the data, because people are looking for managing interact with the big data. So essentially, the new paradigm when you build the interactive tool is try to create some an intelligence system. So I work in this Watson project, and create my mission is create this visual dialogue. So essentially, create a verbalization of this visual knowledge. Essentially, what you need to do is to understand your user. So the user has many information, so you need to understand the personality, the cognitive style, what type of visualization you like more, and if you have familiarity with what type of graph. And you can understand here with many machine learning systems, you can put interactive tools to understand from the way the user interacts what really is the profile of him. And is an expert, is an expert from the domain, and what is the motivation? Because you know, the motivation, the skill changes completely. The interpretation of the data visualization. So I make for Luis and this quickly experiment, because the tool is online, easy to use, where I'm using your tweet to understand your personality. So I don't know if this really work, because you tweet just 60 times. I'm not the best tweeter that I met in my career, but I don't know, Dirk is still here. So I try to, of course, not create some experiments or plot the personality of different people, but don't worry, just two people. But if you want to understand your personality, or much better, in what way machine learning system can understand from interpretation of your style, and the way to write your Twitter, you can use this tool easily. And essentially, in this case, I was looking myself. Don't read this personality, because I don't really like the way they describe me, but I have some visualization to understand what their characteristic. But the most important things, you can use this profiling of the user to match, identify the best content to share with him. So in function of what the skill they have, what type of, all the parameters we saw before. So in what way to do that, essentially in this case, we are able to identify for this person, in this case me, what are the best content in a TED. So identify this collection of five video, but can be more. You have to set the parameter. Essentially, for my style in tweet, but you can use many other type of resource, identify this five speech. So I think a little bit more interesting that use Twitter, just use all the title of that I saw in this during this beautiful 2 days in this conference, understand if using this title there are some good match with a video to look together. Don't worry, because I have other 3 minutes, so we will not see all this video together, but I think this is a selection. Of course, I don't know why there is a Kalahari desert that's come out. Maybe some of you can explain me, but of course, after the sociology universe system, and there are interesting topics that talk about European Central Bank, and of course, emission, CO2 emission, things like that. And of course, it's something more interesting looking at this tool from the point of view of a Google user. So Google user, and people that use Google intensely usually have this habit to write a question. No? You know that the people outside are looking for very high level of interaction. So you cannot deliver something that just is interactive with your data. You need to create a question answer technology. Or use API for question answer technology that come from another company. I put this question, and this is and our tool is able to identify these topics. Of course, the technology is very intuitive. You can see we use question answer technology, semantic video annotation, summarization. You have to identify the segment in the video that really match with the question, not to give the answer. Of course, in a corporate like a TED, you don't have a really answer, because it's like a not pedagogic type of talk, but you can ingest easily any type of data. So of course, I use a video just because to show you that we can use unstructured information, like a video, of course, is a most important example. So, but you can imagine it can be done for any type of information. And essentially here we identify different segments, they are consistent in type of topics, original for the topics we identify in the segment, and so on. After there is the other side, I have only 1 minute to show you, but I don't want to create a panic. Essentially, the other side is understand and look a little bit what's going on in the machine. So everything looks so beautiful, easy to use, but inside is incredibly complicated. And this is an overview of the technology that we're using to build this interface you looked before. These are a little bit deep overview of all the components that you need to in some way build to create this cognitive machine that really understand, interact easily with the user. And of course, we cannot see every single component, but I was thinking to close with you with this overview about the knowledge graph type of, so I think many of you are building knowledge graph to monitoring the information that you're reading. I think scientists now, today, I'm going to close my speech, need to use this technology because there's too much data outside. So you need to create a rank of priority what paper read first and what paper meet first. And in this case, we can see an interesting a way to write and you can write a sentence, you can write just a keyword, identify what is a connection. In this case, we're using Wikipedia, like a corpus. It's completely unsupervised system, so in few minutes, you can ingest your data, and you can create this knowledge graph of your content, understand what is a correlation between different terms. I think for people that come from semiotic field, you can recognize from this disposition of result something that come from very famous person in the field, but I don't have too much time to really describe why this layout and why this interface works. So just across to with this recommendation, if you want to know more about the way that this technology work and you want to apply this technology in your field, just send me a mail, connect with me, I will explain much more and maybe help you with some great, transform you in a rock star. I think you deserve that. Thank you so much.